Welcome to the Hindu News Analysis by Shankar IAS Academy. These are the list of news articles chosen for today's discussion. They are given along with the page numbers of different editions. The link for the handwritten notes in PDF format and the timestamping for the discussed articles are provided in the description box as well as in the comment section for the benefit of mobile phone viewers. Let us now move on to the analysis of the first news article. Now let us take up this news article, which talks about a plea in the Supreme Court seeking a direction from it to repeal the provisions which criminalizes begging in the nation. And the plea claimed that the sections of the statute that criminalizes begging were found to be violative of the constitutional rights, and it also referred to the August 2018's verdict of the Delhi High Court, which had decriminalized begging in the national capital. So in this regard, the Supreme Court has asked the center and four states, including Maharashtra, Gujarat, Punjab and Haryana, to file their response within 3 weeks. And even though a notice was issued to these four states and also Bihar on the plea, only Bihar has so far filed its response. So in this context, let us have a brief understanding about legislation on begging in India. See, we should know that there is no national legislation dealing with beggary in India. After independence in 1947, many Indian states have beggary laws. Of all the state enactments, the Bombay Prevention of Begging Act of 1959 has been in the limelight. Now, this is especially because of its application in the metropolis of Mumbai and the subsequent extension to the Union Territory of Delhi in 1960. But the Delhi High Court, in a landmark judgment titled Harsh Mandar versus the Union of India and Karnik Sone versus the Union of India, held the Bombay Prevention of Begging Act of 1959 as unconstitutional. And it was held unconstitutional on the grounds that it violates the Article 14 and Article 21 of the Indian Constitution. See, we should know that criminalizing begging violates the fundamental rights of the most vulnerable people in our society. And also it ignores the reality that the poorest of the poor are forced to beg not as a choice but as a last resort owing to various socioeconomic conditions. And as a recent plea has noted, it is a government which is mandated to provide social security to everyone and to ensure that all had basic facilities as embedded in the DPSP or the Directive Principles of State Policy of our Constitution. However, the presence of beggars is the evidence that the state has failed to provide these basic facilities to all its citizens. So in this regard, know that the provisions of the Railway Act of 1989 also criminalizes begging. And now the Ministry of Railways has proposed to amend the provisions of the Act in order to decriminalize or to rationalize the penalties for begging. Here, Section 144, Subsection 2 of the Railway Act says that if any person begs in any railway carriage or at a railway station, then he or she shall be liable for punishment, which is imprisonment, for a term that may extend to 1 year or with a fine that may extend to ₹2,000 or with both. But now, the proposed amendment to the subsection 2 of this section states that no person shall be permitted to beg in any railway carriage or upon any part of the railway. So this means at present, the severity of the punishment is considerably reduced, or we can say that there will be no punishment for begging in railway. With this, we have come to the end of this news discussion. Look at this news article. The article talks about the new discovery of quasars. First, let's understand about quasars. See, the term quasar derives from how these objects were originally discovered in the earliest radio surveys of the sky back in 1950s. They were dubbed quasi-stellar radio sources because of the bright star-like appearance, and they were rechristened by 1964 to be quasar. Know that perhaps one of the most perplexing mysteries in current astrophysics is the science behind these quasars. See, quasars are the brightest and most distant star-like object that is found in the known universe. In fact, they are so bright and they emit so much energy that some of them are believed to be producing around 10 to 100 times more energy than the entire Milky Way galaxy. So from this you can get a picture of how large amount of energies are being emitted by them. So what is this quasar exactly? See, until recently, the purpose of these energetic objects was a subject of controversy. Now it's generally agreed upon that quasars are produced by supermassive black holes consuming matter. See, in 1963, the first measurement of the distance to a quasar, that is a radio source that looks like a star in visible light, showed it to be an enormously powerful beacon lying billions of light years away. Now, let me get to the basics to explain this. We know black holes are massive structures of gravity that even light doesn't travel past it. When an object nears a black hole, under the influence of the black hole, it is drawn towards it faster and faster in that process. The objects that are drawn are set off for a spin around the black hole with increasing velocity as they spiral towards the center, that is the black hole. And as the matter spins faster and faster, it gets heated up, thus giving off massive amounts of light and other forms of radiation such as X-rays, light rays, gamma rays and radio waves. Since light cannot escape the supermassive black holes that are at the center of quasars, the escaping energy is actually generated outside the event horizon. See, a event horizon is nothing but the boundary that is defining the region of space around a black hole from which nothing, not even light, can escape. Quasars are observed so far away and in relatively young galaxies, and it is believed that they could be the first step in the evolutionary process of a galaxy. And perhaps the supermassive black hole at the center of a galaxy once hosted a quasar. Now, coming to the article talks about the newly discovered quasars, and this rare discovery increases the number of known quasars or quads by about 25%, and also they can help determine the expansion rate of the universe in addition to addressing other mysteries like dark matter. Remember, these quasars are also called as quads due to the formation structure in the sky. So with this information, let's move on to the next article. Now let us take up this news article from the Science and Tech column. This article talks about the Indus and Ganges River dolphins, and the article says that both are different species. So first let us know about the two dolphins and then let us discuss this article. The syllabus relevant for this news article is highlighted below for your reference. First, I'm talking about Indus River dolphins. They are believed to have originated in the ancient Tethys Sea. What happened is, when the sea dried up approximately 50 million years ago, the dolphins were forced to adapt to its only remaining habitat, that is rivers. And today they can be found in the lower parts of the Indus River in Pakistan and in River Bias, which is a tributary of the Indus River in Punjab in India. It is to be noted that in Pakistan, their numbers declined dramatically after the construction of an irrigation system, and hence in that country, most dolphins are confined to a 750-mile stretch of the river, and they are divided into isolated populations by 6 barrages. The total population of the Indus River dolphins is estimated to be around 2,000, and each of them weigh about 70 to 110 kilograms. Remember, they have adapted to life in the muddy river, and their eyes are so small that scientists believe that they are functionally blind. Also, they rely on echolocation to navigate, communicate, and hunt their prey, which includes prawns, catfish, and carp. Now, on talking about the threats posed to them, more Indus dolphins are dying as a result of accidentally being caught in the fishing nets, which is also known as bycatch. Also, some communities who rely heavily on fishing, they think of the Indus River dolphin as a competition for fish. And so poaching still occurs despite a ban on hunting. And apart from these, untreated sewage, industrial pollution, pesticides from sugarcane and cotton crops, etc., also pollute the river, which causes destruction to their habitats. Note that the Indus River dolphins are listed as endangered on the IUCN Red List, and they are included in Appendix 1 of sites. And importantly, they are also included in Schedule 1 of the Wildlife Protection Act of 1972. Now, on talking about the Gangetic River dolphin, it was officially discovered in the year 1801. Earlier, these dolphins were spotted in the Ganges, Brahmaputra, Meghna and Karnaphuli Sangu river systems of Nepal, India and Bangladesh. However, at present, the species is extinct from a major part of its early distribution ranges, and it is to be noted that in 2009, they were declared as a national animal by the government of India. Their total population is estimated at several thousand individuals spread across the rivers of Bangladesh, India and Nepal, and they weigh about 150 to 170 kilograms. Know that the Ganges River dolphin can only live in fresh water, and it is essentially blind. So being blind, they catch their prey in the same manner like that of the Indus dolphin, that is by emitting an ultrasonic sound which reaches the prey, and the dolphin then registers this image in its mind and it subsequently catches hold of its prey. It is to be noted that they are frequently found alone or in small groups, and generally a mother and a calf travel together. These cubs are chocolate brown at birth and then have grey-brown, smooth, hairless skin as adults. Remember, the females are larger than males and they give birth once in every 2 to 3 years, that too only one calf. Now, when we talk about the threats to these dolphins, many dolphins die as a result of bycatch, and then the Ganges River dolphins are also hunted for meat and oil, which are both used medicinally. Their oil is also used to attract the catfish in net fishery. Apart from this, industrial, agricultural and human pollution is also another serious cause of habitat degradation, because each year around 9,000 tons of pesticides and 6 million tons of fertilizers are used in the vicinity of the river. So we know that high levels of pollution can directly kill prey species and dolphins, and they have the potential to completely destroy their habitat. Know that, being the top predator, these river dolphins have been known to have high levels of persistent toxic chemicals in their bodies, which is likely to cause adverse effects on their health. And remember, they are also listed as endangered on the IUCN Red List, and they are included in Appendix 1 of CITES and also in Schedule 1 of the Wildlife Protection Act of 1972. Now, let us talk about the recent research. See, it is to be noted that currently both Indus and Ganges River dolphins are classified as two subspecies under Latanista gangetica. But as per a recent study that was conducted by a team from the University of St. Andrews, UK, found out that the dolphins in the Indus River and those in the Ganges Brahmaputra rivers are sufficiently distinct to be classified as species in their own right. And it estimates that Indus and Ganges River dolphins may have diverged around 550,000 years ago. And the difference in their species was established with the help of their DNA. Further, the research also showed that the two river dolphin species have different numbers of teeth, coloration, growth patterns and skull shapes, as well as clear genetic differences. For your additional information, other than Indus dolphin and Gangetic dolphin, the following river dolphins remain worldwide. And they include the Irrawaddy dolphins, the Yangtze finless porpoise, the Amazon river dolphin and the Tukuzi. Now let us take up this news article titled, "Paying Extortion Money is Not Terror Funding." See, this article is regarding a Supreme Court judgment. It said that extortion money paid to a terrorist organization in order to protect one's business is not terror funding. So in this regard, the Apex Court released a Ranchi-based coal businessman who was booked under the Unlawful Activities Prevention Act. So in this context, let us discuss in brief about the Unlawful Activities Prevention Act and also some of its provision. The syllabus covered by this article is highlighted below. First of all, let us understand the issue. As we know, the Communist Party of India, or Maoist in short, is the largest and the most lethal Naxalite or left-wing extremist group in India. To run its war machinery of huge size, they require a huge amount of finance. As per a 2013 report, Maoists raise around 140 to 250 crore a year through extortion, protection rackets, etc. Now let us see the major sources of finance for the Maoist. See, money is collected from individuals as well as businesses ranging from petty to big industries. The public work department contractors, the mining industry, illegal mining of minerals, big industries, then businessmen, timber contractions, bamboo contractors, etc. form the sources of finances for these Maoists, and the rebels also levy taxes in their strongholds. In fact, it is said that Jharkhand is the treasury of the Maoists, and there is a symbiotic relationship between the Maoist and illegal mining as well as forest produce. See, the PWD contractors are an important target for extortion by these Maoists, and the amount extorted is determined by the nature of the work and its cost. Know that extortion is a crime of obtaining something from someone, especially money, by using force or threats. Now let us see the darker side of extortion. As all the actors involved get a share of the pie, everyone is happy, and this refers to the contractors, the Maoists and the public servants. And eventually, due to the poor quality of the works completed, it is the people who suffer at the end. And also in the affected areas, because of these extortion and corruption, the projects have been falling into the vicious cycle of time and cost escalation. And today's article is also one such case, wherein a coal businessman in Jharkhand was forced to pay extortion money to the Tritiya Prashtuti Committee, which is a splinter group of the Communist Party of India. And so he was charged with funding of terror, and now the Supreme Court has freed him. Now let us understand in brief about this Unlawful Activities Prevention Act of 1967. See, this act provides for more effective prevention of certain unlawful activities of individuals and associations and for dealing with terrorist activities. Know that Chapter 4 of the Act deals with the punishment for terrorist activities, and under this, Section 17 deals with the punishment for raising funds for terrorist act. This section says that whoever in India or in a foreign country directly or indirectly raises or provides funds, whether from a legitimate or illegitimate source, from any person, or even if they attempt to provide or collect cash for any person, knowing that such funds are likely to be used by a terrorist organization to commit a terrorist act, will be punishable with imprisonment for a term which shall not be less than 5 years, but which may extend to imprisonment for life. And also know that the first schedule of this act has banned many terrorist organizations. It includes the Communist Party of India, all its formations and front organization. And further, it also includes Maoist Communist Center, all its formations and front organization. Under this comes the Tritiya Prashtuti Committee, which is a splinter Maoist group, which is also banned. So with this, we have come to the end of the discussion of this topic. Let's move on to the next news article. See this article. This article says that the population of dolphins in Chilika Lake and along the coast of Odisha has doubled this year in comparison with the previous year. And during the population estimation exercise, 3 species of dolphins were recorded, and they include the Irrawaddy, bottlenose and humpback dolphins. Now, on coming to the news article, the good news is that there is a sizable growth in the population of endangered Irrawaddy dolphins. So, we know that Irrawaddy dolphins are found in the coastal areas in the south and southeast part of Asia. And they are mainly found in 3 rivers, which includes the Irrawaddy in Myanmar, the Mahakam in Indonesian Borneo and the Mekong. This Irrawaddy dolphin is not a true river dolphin, but an oceanic one that lives in the brackish water near coasts, river mouths and in estuaries. And when you take in India, they are mainly found along the Odisha coast in Chilika and Gahirmata. Have a look at the map to understand its habitat in a better way. See, the main threat to this Irrawaddy dolphin is the entanglement in gillnets, habitat loss and degradation from pollution, dam construction, sedimentation and vessel traffic are additional concerns. Also, these dolphins are revered in many parts of Asia. On moving further, this Irrawaddy dolphin is legally protected from deliberate capture in most of its range, and specially protected areas have been designated in several areas in this regard. Also, the restrictions on the use of gillnets are necessary to reduce entanglement mortality, and the use of non-entangling and more selective gear is to be encouraged. Now, let us discuss about this Chilika Lake. See, this Chilika Lake is a brackish water lake and a shallow lagoon with an estuarine character that is spread across the districts of Puri, Gurda and Ganjam in Odisha. This lake is fed by around 52 rivers and rivulets, and the most prominent among them are Daya, Bargavi and the Luna rivers. Know that the Chilika Lagoon has been designated as a Ramsar site, a wetland of international importance since 1981, and the Nalaban Island within the lake is notified as a bird sanctuary under the Wildlife Protection Act of 1972. And further, this Chilika Lagoon is a hotspot of rich biodiversity because it is very rich in both invertebrate and vertebrate fauna, and also it is the habitat for the largest congregation of waterfowls in India. And presently, this Chilika Lake is threatened by siltation, eutrophication and also the change in salinity regime, etc. In addition to these, there is also a threat from proliferation of freshwater weed, increased aquaculture activities, changes in species composition, depletion of bioresources, and decrease in fish population, etc. With this, let us now move on to the practice question discussion. With reference to the Irrawaddy dolphins, consider the following statements. Statement 1, it is an oceanic dolphin that lives in brackish water near coasts, river mouths and in estuaries. Statement 2, in India, they are mainly found along the Arabian coast. So we need to find the correct statement. See, when you look at statement 1, which says that it is an oceanic dolphin that lives in brackish water is correct. But when you look at statement 2, it is incorrect. This is because in India, they are mainly found along the Odisha coast in Chilika and Gahirmata and not in the western coast. So therefore, the right option is option A, that is one only. Consider the following statements. Currently, there is no national legislation dealing with beggary in India. Statement 2, the Supreme Court of India had recently repealed the Bombay Prevention of Beggary Act of 1959 as unconstitutional and asked the state governments to repeal their laws which criminalize begging. Which of the above given statements is or are correct? See, the first statement is correct. As we have discussed, currently there is no national legislation dealing with beggary in India. But after independence in 1947, many Indian states have beggary laws and most of them have used the Bombay Prevention of Beggary Act of 1959 as a basis for their own laws. When you look at the second statement, it is incorrect. This is because it is a Delhi High Court in a landmark judgment in Harsh Mandar versus the Union of India and Karnika Sone versus the Union of India, which held the Bombay Prevention of Begging Act of 1959 as unconstitutional and that too only in the national capital. And now, as today's news says, the Supreme Court is hearing a plea seeking a direction from it to repeal the act which criminalizes begging in the nation, and it is yet to pronounce a verdict in this regard. So therefore, the right statement is option A, that is one only. With reference to quasars, consider the following statements. Statement 1, they emit only radio waves, so they are low energy entities of space. Statement 2, discovery of quasars can give insights into dark matter of space. And you need to find the right option. See, quasars are high energy phenomenon that emit light, radio waves, X-rays, etc. So, based on this, we can infer that statement 1 is wrong. Coming to statement 2, as seen in the discussion, quasars help in understanding space better, including the dark matter. So therefore, this statement is correct. Since the question wants us to find the correct statements, the right option is option B, that is 2 only. Now look at this prelims question. Consider the following statements with reference to India's freshwater dolphins. Statement 1, dolphins in the Indus River and those in the Ganges Brahmaputra rivers are fishes of different species. Statement 2, both Indus River dolphins and Gangetic Brahmaputra River dolphins are listed as endangered in the IUCN Red List. And you need to find the correct statement. See, when you look at the first statement, it is incorrect. See, in the first statement, one part is correct. That is, as found out by the recent research, both are of different species. But read the question carefully. It mentions the term fishes. So know that dolphins are not fishes, but they are mammals, and unlike fish who breathe through gills, the dolphins, they breathe air using lungs. And also know that dolphins are capable of complex problem solving and social interactions. And in fact, they are one of the smartest animal in the world. The research into the behavior of dolphins, both in wild as well as in captivity, has yielded incredible data on the intelligence of these marine mammals. Now coming to the second statement, which says that they are listed as endangered in the IUCN Red List, is correct. So since you need to find the right option, the correct option is option B, that is 2 only. The list of mains practice question is displayed here. You can write your answers and post them in the comment section below. With this, we have come to the end of today's Indo News analysis. If you like the video, don't forget to like, comment and share, and do subscribe to Shankar IAS Academy YouTube channel for more updates regarding UPSC Civil Services preparation.